Dr. Welner, well, thank you for joining me. It's a really complex issue, this, because there are many issues around guns in America, but this particular one of crazy people doing crazy things. What can you do to try and red flag these people?
Well, homicide, murder, is a byproduct of many different qualities, and you can't generalize about murder, but you can generalize about mass shooting. Look, mental illness wasn't just invented. Neither were guns. And yet we've seen a proliferation in recent decades of mass murder. And why? Because there's a social payoff. There is the vehicle, through hyperexposure of news coverage and relevance, of a person who's unremarkable, as has just been described, or failing, who had high expectations of himself. We don't see homeless mentally ill doing this. We don't see people with chronic conditions. We see people who are unremarkable, who crawl into the cracks because they are not obviously ill, even if they have a psychiatric condition, who recognize there's a social payoff, that we will talk about them on your show or their perceived grievance, people who know they can go in an instant from being unremarkable to relevant at the very least, and notorious jokers or anti-heroes, or in the example of Paige, the person in the white supremacist movement who actually got up and did something, which in my experience of dealing with the white supremacist community, you have plenty of folks in these chat rooms who grouse about nobody getting up and doing something, and then someone says, I will rise above and I'll become relevant to them. It is a social phenomenon people seeking relevance that we reinforce, and so the next person inspired by watching how we cover it basically chooses shock value, recognizing that if they're shocking enough and creative enough, so you eliminate guns, they'll pick bombs.
Right. I mean, look, to me, that's always a very simplistic argument. If you had that argument with terrorism, for example, if you said about Al-Qaeda, okay, they blew up the World Trade Center, but you know what? If they weren't doing that, they'd be doing something else. We're going to leave them alone to do their thing. You can't just leave these people to do their thing. You can't just say, well, if it wasn't guns, it would be bombs. My issue about Page, for example, is this. There is a man who was thrown out of the army for misconduct. He had a criminal record. He was in a high-profile, relatively high-profile band full of skinhead white supremacists who were spouting vile stuff about anybody non-white in America. You've got a clearly dangerous, criminally-minded, unstable character with a vested interest in doing exactly the kind of thing that he did. How do we flag up people like him? Because the media, within a few hours of his name coming out, can tell you all about him, and the American people can say, here are 20 reasons why he shouldn't be given a gun. Yet he was able to walk in, I think 2 weeks ago, and purchase the gun that caused the mayhem. What do we do about that?
Well, two things. First of all, he was able to purchase the gun because he wasn't obviously disturbed. And secondly, there are thousands of people, whether we like it or not, who think like him and who may be even more venomous and vituperative in what they have to say. He became invested in the social payoff. The reason I mentioned bombs is merely to say bombs are an instrument of spectacle. When something is blown up, people notice. And the guns and the idea of mass destruction, if guns are not available and someone is motivated to mass destruction.
Don't you have to make it, in all these cases, don't you just have to make it as difficult as you possibly can for people of this kind of mentality, who may not be flagged up under the current system, to acquire these kind of assault weapons and handguns and so on? I mean, why do you really need to have a handgun or assault weapon of the type that they're using to commit these things, unless it is to do harm?
Mass shooting is an endpoint in an individual who may have mental illness and who may not. At some point, others recognize them as either troubled or just invested in the idea of destruction. But when they become determined to embark on a mass murder, they're quiet, they're private, and they make sure that they're not going to be detected.
Final question, though. I mean, from all that you have seen, of all the cases you've been involved in and so on, do you think there is a coherent argument to just have tougher gun laws in America?
I don't agree. I think, for example, just in terms of I think that there is sufficient evidence of instances in which, simply put, mass shooters pick soft targets. They picked areas where they know folks will be unarmed, will be helpless and defenseless. Yeah,
again, I come back to the Al-Qaeda analogy. So do terrorists.
That's exactly right. Right.
But we don't just leave them alone. We go after terrorists with all the power of the federal government. We have the FBI, the CIA, MI6 in Britain, whatever it may be. You go after everything you can. Sure. Their bank accounts, their this, their ability to get weapons, all these things.
Sure.
New laws are brought in. We go through airports. And we have to go through a million different things now because of what they did. I don't see the same treatment of these gun outrages that is applied to terrorist attacks.
In my professional opinion, and I've worked on terrorism cases, there are two different forces at play. Terrorism is a culmination of an organized activity that is not done in isolation in the same way as these mass shooting phenomena are carried out by folks who, if they have an ideology, it's cosmetic.